Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Farron Cousins, and here's what's happening tonight. AT&T has been helping the U.S. spy on its own citizens, and we'll explain how the telecom giant became the government's number one data miner. President Obama has some harsh words for the Republican anti-immigration crowd, and he's got some unlikely allies in this fight. We'll explain in a moment. And Rick Perry's wealthy donors want their money back. We'll bring you the details in tonight's backstory. And that's what's coming up. You just stepped in to the Ring of Fire.
There's been zero warming, none whatsoever.
I'm running for president of the United States.
Congress declares war, not the president. Start with the countries that are burning our flags.
We regret these errors and apologize.
We apologize.
We apologize.
And apologize.
This is good news, people.
We're now into week two of our fall Free Speech TV fundraiser, and I wanted to take a minute to thank everyone that has pledged to help support Free Speech TV and to explain why your support is sorely needed right now. Free Speech TV does not take corporate money, and that's why your financial support is so important, because you can help protect free speech today with your donation. Free Speech TV airs independent news and views for independent thinkers like yourself. Everyone should have access to news and information that is not influenced by corporations. Our goal is to keep you and everyone out there involved. Now, we aim to reach every viewer possible because we're all in this together, but we cannot do that without your support. So please go online to freespeech.org and pledge to help support independent, honest news journalism. You can also call our hotline at 877-378-8669 and donate over the phone. Your support helps to keep information flowing, and together we can hold the corporate media accountable. Now, in addition to the information that Free Speech TV will continue to provide because of your financial support, you can also get a few other perks for donating. Your donation is tax deductible, and there are also several donation levels that give you some great items in return. With a pledge of $60, you'll get a Corporations Are Not People Free Speech TV stamp. A donation of $120 will get you two Ring of Fire mugs. A pledge of $240, you'll receive a Free Speech TV bear with the Free Speech TV family 10 button set, which is a great way to show your support for your favorite Free Speech TV programs. And for a donation of $360, you'll get the Free Speech TV bear with the Free Speech TV family 10 button set and the Corporations Are Not People Free Speech TV stamp. We thank you for all of your support. In other news today, President Obama finally came out and said what most of us have already been thinking about the Republicans' war on immigrants. At a town hall in Iowa last week, Obama took a sharp jab at Republicans, saying that their anti-immigrant rhetoric was contrary to who we are as a country, and that unless you're a Native American, then your ancestors came from somewhere else. Now, this is just the latest in a long line of attacks coming from President Obama. In the last few weeks, he's gone after the Republicans for their backwards policies on both climate change and the economy. And this is what Obama does best, and I'm sure that almost everyone watching this program is excited to see the return of the Obama that isn't afraid to confront his opposition. But Obama isn't the only one going after the Republicans' attacks on immigrants. Even some conservative groups say that the GOP is taking things way too far on this issue. Recently, the Koch brother-funded group called the Libra Initiative issued an open letter to all Americans asking them to reject the extreme anti-immigrant language being adopted by Republican politicians. And just last week, business leaders led by the U.S. Chamber of Commerce said that they were weary of a Donald Trump presidency due in part to his hard-line stance against immigrants. Of course, both the Koch-funded group and the business groups aren't concerned about the fact that candidates like Trump aren't treating immigrants like human beings. They're concerned about the effect on their profit margins if their favorite source of cheap labor is shipped out of the country. But the bottom line is that the harsh language being used by candidates is not sitting well with anyone except for the extreme fringe of the Republican base, and that's not going to translate into votes next November. And speaking of things that don't resonate with voters, Rick Perry may not be running for president anymore, but he's still sitting on millions of dollars of super PAC money. Now, he has several options about what he can do with that money, but his donors have issued a very stern message to him. We want our money back. Specifically, Doug Deason, the son of Darwin Deason, a donor who gave Perry's Super PAC $5 million, said that his father expects the money to be returned. But the Super PAC, called the Opportunity and Freedom PAC, said that they don't have any firm plans just yet, and they're discussing their options with their team of lawyers right now. But that's not good enough for the Deason family, and they've made it clear that they're expecting the Super PAC to shut down and promptly send them a check. But you know what I think? I think the Perry Super PAC should keep this money. It sends a message to wealthy donors that pouring millions of dollars into political campaigns is never a sure thing. It's a gamble. And as any gambler is going to tell you, sometimes you win, sometimes you lose. And the Deason family lost big time by betting on Rick Perry. So as long as it's legal, go ahead and keep the money. Stand your ground and let the millionaire class know what it's like to get screwed over by a politician for once. That's my advice. And finally today, the state of Alabama has made it to the 21st century, or at least the 20th century. State officials in Alabama have announced that students will now be required to learn about both evolution and climate change as part of school curriculum. Now, before now, teachers were not required to teach anything that could be deemed, quote, controversial, regardless of the science behind the issue. However, textbooks are still going to carry a warning stating that evolution is a controversial theory rather than a scientific principle. The new standards are the state's attempts to bring students up to the national level, as right now only 21% of 10th graders in the state of Alabama meet the national average for scientific knowledge for their grade. The state also currently ranks 37th in the country in ACT scores. The Republican-controlled legislature in Alabama approved the new standards, which marks the first time in a decade that the state's education curriculum is being updated, and teachers in the state are actually optimistic that the new standards are going to help pull the state out of the educational abyss that they've been falling into for far too long. We need to take a short break, but we'll be right back.
In 1980, 52 separate corporations owned the media, ranging from newspapers to magazines to television. TV media was considered a marketplace for important ideas and investigative stories. America had one of the most vibrant media infrastructures in the world. Today, five multi-conglomerate corporations own all the media, all the TV, all the radio, the newspapers, and the magazines. The truth is, meaningful reporting has died. It's created a window, a void that can be occupied by outlets like Free Speech TV, where advertisers and powerful politicos and MBAs don't tell us what we can or cannot report. Corporate media is dead or dying. But truth-teller outlets like Free Speech TV, well, they're now just being born. So here's the problem. If you want reporting that's not controlled by a corporate-owned and dominated CEO, if you believe you deserve a sincere reporting outlet that has no allegiance to a political party, if you understand that our democracy requires diversity and truthfulness, it requires courage and it requires commitment to telling the whole truth about wars, telling the truth about our economy or corporate corruption or the truth about our environment. If you understand that correlation, then you must understand that you're in control of all of that. Not the Beltway, not Wall Street, not Madison Avenue. You are in control of empowering Free Speech TV by giving us financial support, the tools to do what we promise to do for you every day, right here on Ring of Fire, for example, 5 days a week. My pledge to you is that not a dollar is going to be wasted. Every dollar you pledge to Free Speech TV is going to be honored as your commitment to change news reporting right here. Right now, that you can do that by supporting what we do. The truth is, we're a family here at Free Speech TV who cares for, believes in, and advocates for what you believe in every day. I'm asking for your financial support to allow us to do our job the way you deserve, to do our job the way you expect us to do. Go online to freespeech.org to help keep honest, independent media on the air. In the truest sense, Free Speech TV has the potential to be our line in the sand, a statement that TV reporting does have the capacity to create the kind of outrage that puts Wall Street white-collar criminals in prison once and for all. You see, your voice, and it is your voice that's delivered through free speech TV programming, and it really does have the potential outrage that demands that we save our planet from fossil fuel outlaws who are going to drill and frack until our grandchildren exist around irreversible environmental catastrophe. It's your voice. When you turn on Free Speech TV, you're going to hear your outrage, your demands articulated by some of the most important voices in progressive media. Tom Hartman or Amy Goodman, real journalists who have devoted their lives to being your voice for your causes. It is your voice that stays alive if you believe what you think every day. It's your voice, what you believe every day, what you're committed to every day, can show up on a network like Free Speech TV. Your voice delivered on a sustainable TV outlet unlike any other network. It is your voice that kept us out of a war in Syria, ladies and gentlemen. It's your voice that saved the internet from corporate media control. It was your voice, your outrage, that forced Obama time after time to do what he was unwilling to do at first. Free Speech TV, simply put, is your voice. Believe that your voice, your beliefs are important enough to be heard. And I promise you, I will speak your voice. But to do that, I need your help. Go to freespeech.org and help preserve your voice in the national media.
AT&T is one of the top companies helping the NSA collect the private data of U.S. citizens. Now, not once during the Republican debates last week did the issue of domestic spying come up, but the problem does seem to be getting worse on the national level. Joining me now to talk about AT&T's role in domestic surveillance is Michael Berg. Michael, I don't think that there's anybody who's watching this program right now that doesn't fully understand, you know, the scope and the depth of the NSA's domestic spying policies. What they may not know really is how complicit and cooperative a lot of these telecom giants have been. I know AT&T stands out as possibly one of the biggest accomplices to the U.S. government. Tell us a little bit about the role that AT&T has played in turning over data.
They've been turning over data long before it was known by the public. AT&T has been, they refer to as a partnership with the government in terms of turning over all the data they have to the government in a very secretive way that we'll never know. But I think of all the telecoms, AT&T has been the number one partner to the U.S. government in terms of its spying on its own citizens.
Well, you know, I think it's interesting, too, because this has actually gone back long before we had the 9/11 attacks. Right. This was before anybody even knew what Al-Qaeda was or ISIS or anything. Islamic fundamentalism wasn't something we talked about. But AT&T, as far back as we see in the 1980s, I believe it was, they were turning over phone records to the government as part of this big program right after the big monopolies were kind of broken up a bit. So how far back does this thing actually go? I mean,
well, I think you're right. As far as we know, it goes back to the 80s. It may go even farther back than that. And what's interesting about it is, you know, right now the government and listen, the United States is the greatest country in the world. I want to make sure everybody understands that. And we do have a security issue here. But if you look all the way back into the 1980s, before, as you mentioned, before Al-Qaeda, before any terrorist attacks, AT&T was giving them phone records, information about our U.S. citizen. I always go back to 1984, George Orwell's Big Brother book. And I remember when I read that back in the 60s, I thought, this could never happen in America. This is not going to be an America that we're going to be living in. But not only is it have we reached what he described, Orwell described in 1984, but we've gone way beyond that. You know, yes, we need to have security. Yes, we need to make sure that we're safe here on U.S. soils and abroad. But this unlimited, warrantless, without subpoenas, without court orders, going out and getting U.S. citizens' data, information, their emails, their phone records, their telephone calls, is just beyond anything that we should tolerate in America. There has to be a balance.
Well, you know what's interesting is that every time that this program or any piece of this program, this domestic spying, has come before a judge, it is, I believe almost 100% of the time, has been categorically found to be unconstitutional. There was just a ruling a few months back. I believe a judge up in New York ruled again, program, unconstitutional, cannot do it. Still happening. That's what's kind of crazy. What does that mean? I mean, when it gets ruled unconstitutional by a federal judge and the program still continues, I don't even know how that's still possible.
It's possible because we have the NSA and the U.S. government not following the rule of law. It's no different than the clerk in Kentucky who refused to follow the Supreme Court and issuing, you know, marriage licenses to people who are gay, and she refused to do it because she said, I don't have to follow the law. And when you have a presidential candidate like Huckabee get up there and say, oh yeah, I don't have to follow the Constitution, and he runs for president, but that's no different than what we're seeing here with the NSA. The NSA and the government basically is thumbing their noses at the court system, who has the power invested by the Constitution to put a stop to it. And when you see that it's gone beyond what is allowed under law, that's when we, the people, have to step up and say, no, yes, we want security. Yes, we do need some limited investigation, but we can't keep spying on all our people, giving them billions of data on the hundreds of millions of people that live here in this country.
But, you know, when the government does want to spy on, I don't want to say spy, when they do need to get phone records or emails or any other kind of data, they can go to the FISA court, get a subpoena, get a warrant, and do this legally. There's no reason for this mass collection of data when we already have a system in place, been in place for a very long time, that allows them to do this. And when they do it that way, you know, that is constitutional, that is allowed, that is the rule of law, and it's how law enforcement officers can help stop this. Now, we've only got about a minute left here, but I wanted to ask you, in the Republican debates we've seen so far, not a single mention of domestic surveillance. Admittedly, I did have to take my dog out for about 5 minutes, so I may have missed it if it came up, but Democratic debates, I assume eventually we're going to have one. Do you think this issue will come up during a Democratic debate?
I sure hope so. You know, unfortunately, Senator Udall of Colorado, who led the charge to try to do something to change the system, was defeated in the last election. But there are other people who are looking at this, and the Democrats have to bring this up to the public. It's an important issue. The question is, what kind of America are my children going to have, and hopefully my grandchildren have, that's going to be safe, but yes, secure, and we're not going to have Big Brother spying on us every day and collecting data. And we don't know what they're going to use it for. That's the other thing. We also know that this data can be used for many purposes, and not only for security purposes. And so it's a real slippery slope.
Michael Berg, thank you very much for talking with us today. This is a great story, and we'll check back in with you next week.
Thank you, Farron. Appreciate it.
Last week, a pro-Hillary Clinton super PAC decided to go negative against Senator Bernie Sanders, marking a turning point in the Democratic campaign. But this fight was bound to happen sooner or later as corporatist Democrats and the populist wing of the party continue to battle for the Democratic Party's soul. Recently, Mike Papantonio discussed this battle with Richard Askow, the host of the Zero Hour, so let's take a look at what they had to say.
Richard, you know, I read your stuff very early on years ago. You were talking about the fight for the heart of the Democratic Party. You understood then that we're going to be at this crossroads. You saw us go through the Clinton years where we started losing our identity with what we really were supposed to be. And then for years you've been talking about this topic, and right now it's so important. What is your take? Are we making any progress in trying to understand what the Democratic Party is, what they should be?
Yeah, I think we are. I think we're at a real crossroads now. As you said, I think we've reached the point where with the candidacy of Bernie Sanders, with the rise of Elizabeth Warren, with a lot of grassroots races around the country, we're seeing people saying for the first time within the Democratic Party that this party needs to reestablish itself as the party of the middle class, as the party for eliminating poverty, as the party of working people. And I think there are people saying you can't just do that with rhetorical feints in the right direction. For 30 years, we've seen an entire branch of the Democratic Party that has tried to split the difference between Wall Street fundraising and Wall Street job opportunities and the rhetoric of populism and liberalism. And I think what we've seen is that...
Okay, you hit something really important there. I don't want to miss it, okay? Now, as you were talking about what it is that's splitting the Democratic Party, you mentioned the fundraising. Okay, we get that. We get that the Democrats are out there trying to raise money. But what people don't understand is a lot of people move through this political system with the idea of, gee whiz, I'm going to get a job on the other side of it. And so you'll have staff members move in through a particular administration. They'll work on a campaign. They'll have an administrative position. And then they move to Wall Street. That is kind of part of the way the Democratic avenue has become. It's really no different from the Republican avenue. And so I don't know how you overcome that, because the people that Democrats are attracting right out of school to do this sometimes have that is their intent. Their intent is, this is my start. And so they're going to do what Wall Street wants them to do. They're going to do what corporate America wants them to do. They're going to advise their candidate or whatever, because that's where they're ultimately heading. That's such an important part that we missed of this story.
Well, I think that's exactly right. And I think what we've seen for a number of years now is a Democratic Party dominated by people who are willing to be just liberal enough to get elected while not being so liberal as to endanger job chances or what have you in a future post-political career. And I think what we're seeing now is that the wealth divide has become so great, the financial crisis of the middle class has become so great, the extent of poverty has become so great, on issue after issue after issue, we're finding it's not so easy to split the difference anymore and still be a viable political candidate. That what you have to do in order to change this economy going forward is significantly increase taxes on corporations and on billionaires and millionaires. You have to rein in Wall Street, you have to break up the big banks, and I think when you have an agenda like that, you have to be willing to sacrifice the post-political riches that so many people have become accustomed to. And I think the fact that people have been pulling their punches and sticking with vague rhetorical things about, we want to help the middle class without getting down to specifics, I think that's alienated a large majority
of voters. Richard, you know why it has, and I think you've written about this too. There's very few topics you haven't that you haven't hit on that I think you just precisely get. We heard that language from Obama. We heard that very imprecise language, gee whiz, we have to push back Wall Street, and then there was no pushback. We have to do something about income inequality, and then there really was nothing done. We have to do something about the environment, and then we find him opening as many drilling areas in the United States, I mean, all over the world, than any president that's sat there in six decades. So what they are looking for is that precise language, and we're hearing that language now. Obviously, we're hearing it from Bernie Sanders. Bernie Sanders is not making anything, there's nothing equivocal about what he's saying. And I compare it to where it's kind of these big thought characters. It's like, you know, of all people, Joe Manchin, you know, this should be a Republican. By any other term, Joe Manchin is a Republican. He happens to be a Democrat in West Virginia, but he's a Republican. But he talks about this broad notion of how important Social Security is. But then really, when he goes into any other issue dealing, whether it's breaking up the banks, whether it's the need for infrastructure, whether it's climate change, whether it is funding public schools, whether it's the runaway military, you can't get these types to comment at a peep about what they really believe. But Bernie Sanders is right now.
Well, of course, I think so, and I'm helping Bernie Sanders. But listen, I would love to see every Democratic candidate, including Hillary Clinton, get specific. You mentioned an issue like Social Security. Joe Manchin went on record saying he wants that program expanded. Now, Hillary Clinton said something this week to the effect that we should protect and enhance Social Security. Well, I think we're reaching the show-me age of American politics. So great. Tell me, by what percentage would you increase those benefits? Would you increase them for everyone because we have a retirement crisis in this country? And are you willing to pay for it by lifting the payroll tax cap, which is currently protecting millionaires and billionaires from paying into it at the same rate as middle-class Americans? So, yeah, I think people are going to say, that's great. Show me how you're going to do it, because we've had vague rhetoric before. We're not moved by that anymore. So we'd love to see your specific proposal, like the one that Sanders has endorsed, like the one that Senator Manchin is endorsed, like the one that Senator Warren is endorsed, and so on and so on and so on.
Well, okay, what I'm seeing out here is you know, sometimes in the Beltway people miss things. I don't miss them out here. And the things that I don't miss is that there is a lot of anger. I mean, a lot of anger about, for example, the 13 Democrats who voted for Fast Track. They're the same people. They're exactly the same people who never do anything about climate change, never do anything about public funding of schools, never do anything about NSA spying, never do anything about military budgets. They are Democrats. And like it or not, that unfortunately has become an arm of this party, and it is a struggle this time. Now, my take on it, and I want to see your reaction to it. Bernie has come out and said, he has got to win in the social media. He's got to win in the grassroots. He's got to do something that's so outstanding and create such a groundswell that it looks like an Arab Spring. I mean, it's got to look like that. And is that kind of change going to be enough to move Democrats to think like progressives again?
Well, let's hope so, because I think at this point, the big enemy among most people, I think, you know, look, Mike, you look at the polls, most people believe the way Bernie and the so-called left wing of the Democrats believe. Most people want to expand Social Security, break up the big banks, tax billionaires and corporations and so on. That agenda is the American agenda. But what I think the oligarchs are counting on is the despair of the public, the belief that it's never going to change, the cynical idea that a little tinkering at the top is the best you can expect, and meanwhile, things are going to stay the same. Our kids aren't going to have as good a future as we might have expected once. And I think the answer to it is no. We got to get out in the streets. We got to support candidate like Bernie Sanders. Those 13 Democrats who voted for Fast Track and therefore for another lousy trade deal, each of them should be primaried. Democrats should turn out in droves to turn them out of office. That's the kind of grassroots activism.
Richard, you talk about, and this is nauseating to me, but you're aware of it, I'm aware of it, is these progressive Democrats that say, gee, we have to maintain maximum unity. We simply have to take what we can because the Republicans are so bad. About 20 seconds, tell me your quick thought on that.
Well, I'll tell you, you know, the Clintons always like to say, don't let the perfect be the enemy of the good. I'd say it the other way around. Don't let the mediocre be the enemy of the better. Don't be convinced before the fight even begins that all we can get is more of the same. Be aware of your own power as a people, as a population, as a voter, as an activist, and get out there and do it. We can do a lot better if we mobilize. Let's do it.
Richard Eskow, one of the brilliant people in this business. You are the go-to guy for everybody with Ring of Fire, I can tell you that. Thank you for joining me, Richard.
Thanks, okay, man.
And that's all the time we have for today, but you can get more news, video, and commentary on our website at ringoffireradio.com. And go subscribe to our daily podcast. Just go online to rofpodcast.com. I'm Farron Cousins, and we'll see you tomorrow.